Good evening, everyone. My name is Nick DiBerardino. I'm a composer. I'm the director of composition studies here at Curtis. I'm so thrilled that you joined us tonight for this annual tradition. Tonight, you'll hear each one of our Curtis composers present one of their latest works of chamber music. And I love these concerts because every single piece will be a world premiere. Well, I mean, one of them was previewed on Thursday, but this one counts. So you're in for a treat. So we'd be the first people anywhere in the world to hear this music presented publicly. I think that's very exciting. You'll hear that every one of our composers is a world-class artist. I'm so proud of the work they did writing and rehearsing these pieces this semester. You'll also hear that they are each very distinctive musical voices. So you'll get to know each of them a little bit in the course of this concert through their music, which I always think is exciting. So before we get started, I want to say a quick thank you to Drew, who's our audio engineer. He has done a kind of a wild amount of work for us for this concert and the course of the whole week, so that was a great round of applause. Thank you for that. Another thanks to Chris, who's working the lights in the booth. Love that, Chris. Thanks to Matt, who's leading the video capture team tonight. Bravo. And also Tara, who is running our stage this evening. So one more idea I want to share with you before we begin. I just wanted to tell you that for composers, a recording is a form of currency. So for us as composers, if we want to impress a conductor, try to get on an orchestra season, if we want to apply for a grant and get our next commission funded, if we want to apply for a residency and get some time and space to write our next piece, or if we're still a student and we want to continue studying at another institution, recordings are what we send people. And the good news is we have all the ingredients we need to make phenomenal recordings tonight. We have world-class performers, as you all know. I was at the dress rehearsals today and the musicianship is just stunning, as usual, so it's gonna be a treat tonight. We also have this fantastic facility and these amazing engineers. But there's one more thing we need to make great recordings tonight, and that is for all of us to quickly take out our phones, and I'm gonna do this too, and put them in a mode where they won't make sound. I like airplane mode, because even vibrations can disturb a recording. Okay, so with that done, thank you all. I hope you enjoyed tonight's concert. Here is Maya Miro Johnson to tell you about the first piece on the program.
My name is Maya Miro Johnson, and this semester I was enrolled with Mekhi Gladden in an independent study that investigated the fault lines between media, technology, and aesthetics. The final product of that independent study ended up being a pair of pieces for electroacoustic meta-instrument. The first of which is called Zugzwang A, was premiered on Thursday evening. Zugzwang, by the way, is a term used in chess to indicate a situation in which a player is forced to act, but there is no possible situation that would result in a beneficial outcome. So Zugzwang A concerned the idea of violence in the hypermediated feedback loops, which we are forced into in our society on a daily basis. And this piece B, which you'll see tonight, investigates more the idea of totally deconstructing language down to its subatomic particles. I hope you enjoy, and please enjoy also the rest of the concert. Thank you.
Thank you.
and the documentary is inherent in the tyranny of the camera and the ablation of surgery and music.
Hello everyone, my name is ADRIAN WONG, and I'm the composer of the next piece on the program, Deep Blue. Deep Blue is a piece about the ocean and how it acts as the lungs of the earth, how it literally breathes life into every single living thing on this planet. It is also about human greed and industry and how that is slowly suffocating our oceans. So the piece begins literally from breath. It slowly evolves into the overlapping waves of the ocean. It then grows and grows and grows and careens over itself, folds upon itself, and transforms into the machinery that's killing it. The imagery of the ocean soon returns, and it slowly ebbs away and takes its final breath. The text of the piece is taken from quotes by marine explorers Sylvia Earle and Jacques Cousteau, whose foundations, which are called Mission Blue and the Cousteau Society, respectively, I highly recommend everyone to check out and donate to if you can. I'd like to thank Sam and Alexandra, Sophia, Lingyu, and Ania for the wonderful work that they've done with the piece. I'd also like to thank all the composition faculty for their guidance and support this semester. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Okay, hi everyone. My name is Alistair Coleman, and I'm the composer of the next piece titled Field of Iris. An iris is a flower that has these beautiful bluish, purplish kind of petals that kind of droop down, and they're called falls. They're absolutely stunning, but I later found out that if you ingest the petals of this flower, they can actually become very poisonous and even lethal to animals. And so I felt like this really exemplified so many of the things in life that can be very intoxicating on the surface, but also, you know, potentially very harmful with more intimate interaction. And so, you know, I think about the technology that we use and how, you know, the internet and social media can become so corruptive. You know, the people that we bring into our lives, even in a pandemic where, you know, a beautiful family gathering could become a super spreader event in a way. So all these different things. So with this piece, I really wanted to start in a very innocent kind of place. To introduce a musical object that seems very innocuous on the surface that starts to efficiently kind of take over the piece. And there's a point in time when that object and that development becomes very corruptive. And it causes this acute chaos. And the whole second half of the piece is this rebuilding process that takes place so that at the end of the piece that we actually return to the material from the beginning, but hopefully this time a little bit more matured. So with that, I want to say a huge thank you to the performers, Emma Meinrenken, Matthew Christakos, and Thomas Weaver for all of their amazing work on the piece. To our amazing faculty member, Nick DiBerardino, and all the faculty, and also to you all for coming out. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm the composer of the piece you're about to hear, Rhiannon's Lament. This piece is inspired by a portion of the Mabinogion, which is a collection of medieval Welsh legends. And in this portion of the Mabinogion, a queen, Rhiannon, who's widely respected and loved, has just been accused of murdering her only child. And in this, you know, in this aria, she is lamenting the fact that not only is her son gone, nowhere to be found, but also she's been condemned of this without her husband, the king, or her nurses defending her, and instead they set her up, far from defending her. So hinted at throughout the beginning of the piece, and then revealed later on, you'll hear a reference to a Welsh lullaby, which I imagine she might have sung to her child when he was there, and I imagine she might sing when recollecting his presence and processing all that's just happened and mourning his absence. So I'd like to thank Sophia and Oliver and Daniel, who you'll see here soon, for their work on the piece, and a special thanks to Nick DiBerardino for his guidance throughout the composition process. Hope you enjoy.
such tough acts to follow. Hi, everyone. My name is ELISE ARANCIO. I'm the composer of the next piece, Bathroom of Apathy. First, I just want to say a huge thank you to my performers for all of their amazing work on this piece, John and Sage. And also just a huge thank you to Nick, just for being awesome. So this piece is actually a composed theater piece written as part of a composed theater class led by the great Amy Beth Kirsten that we've all been taking this semester. It was inspired by the first stanza of a poem by Worsen Shire entitled The House. It goes, "Mother says there are locked rooms inside every woman. Kitchen of lust, bedroom of grief, and bathroom of apathy. Sometimes the men, they enter with keys, and sometimes the men, they enter with hammers." Thank you. Thank you.
Gone.
Gone.
They say he should be gone, but then what is he doing under fingernails except being heavy? What is he doing under there? Under hair after it is scraped clean, but never clean, only heavy. Only heavy and gone and going on, being heavy after doing what he is doing, after being clean gone. They say he should not be going, but what is he doing if not going? They say he should not be clean after going, even though he is clean, but just heavy. Fingernails catch him underneath the hair that is scraped and scrubbed raw and skinned, and the skin that was scoured until it did not resemble skin, but maybe it would be shiny, but it was simply heavy and never clean. But what is he doing, they say, what is he doing that is making him so heavy? But it was never what he is doing, but if when he was gone it would be shiny again. It was never shiny or clean before him, but now he has polished the tub with brown hair, shiny hair, and the eyes are brown, and those live under fingernails with him. Those are harder to scrub on account of their heaviness.